Ja, thanks.
Okay, cool. Okay, guys, so you ready, guys? Shall we start? So
Yeah.
yeah, so welcome everybody. This is the second part of Kai Rouling's lecture series, and today we're talking about the round-bit sheaves as reciprocity sheaves. Please.
Yeah. Yes, thanks. Yeah, as I said yesterday, so this will be a short introduction to the theorem bit sheaves, and I will explain how they are reciprocity sheaves, and then we come to more examples this afterwards, and then then tomorrow there will be then I will apply everything which I talked about yesterday and today, and then explain the recent work with Federico Binder and Shuji Saito. Okay, so yeah, maybe first a small motivation why the Deram-Witt complex was considered originally. So this is when you have X, this is a smooth projective scheme over the finite field with P to the n elements. Then one can form the crystalline cohomology. So here, I mean, I will also recall the Witt vectors later, but here we take the Witt vectors of this finite field, and then we invert P. So then this is a vector space over the fraction field of the Witt vectors, say K0. And then we have a Frobenius operating on it. Yeah, so this is a linear map. And so this thing becomes a crystal, what is called an F crystal. And we have a slope decomposition then for such F crystals. So this looks like this here, where now the lambda ranges through the non-negative rational numbers. And so this is a subvector space here on which this F acts with eigenvalues having p-adic valuation equal to lambda. The p-adic valuation is normalized in the way that V of Pn is 1. So this is a classical thing. I mean, actually for this, you don't need that the H is this crystalline cohomology. It's just for any F crystal, you get such a slope decomposition. And so the question was, is this time or why Bloch, I think the main interest why Bloch started with this was the question whether one can give a cohomological interpretation of the slope decompositions. Yeah? So as I said, I mean, in this, in general, you have a slope decomposition for an F crystal, and there's no reason a priori why it should have to do something with cohomology groups. Yeah? And so Bloch introduced this Deram-Witt complex. Also, he introduced it in a slightly different way than we would think of it today, to interpret this slope decomposition in this case in a cohomological way. And then this was generalized by Deligny-Lusy. Bloch's original construction was only working if the dimension of X is smaller or equal P. And then this was generalized. And so the Deram-Witt complex, the idea is that it is a Zariski complex, so like the Deram complex, but somehow mixed with Witt vectors, and whose cohomology computes this crystalline cohomology. And then, as the usual Hodge to Deram spectral sequence, you have also such a spectral sequence here, yeah, which is then called the slope spectral sequence. And this degenerates. So, I mean, here it's important that you invert P. I mean, this spectral sequence also exists when you don't invert P, but then it does not degenerate. And this degenerates, and it gives you such an interpretation of this part here. So when you have the slopes between so greater equal j and strictly smaller than j plus 1, then this part is described by this group here. So and here you have the j's part, the j Witt vectors, appearing. So this was the original motivation, but then somehow this Deram-Witt complex pops up in many different contexts. So this is not the only motivation anymore. So maybe let me recall a bit about Witt vectors. I won't give you the way how to formally define them, because this is anyway useless, but I will tell you the properties which they have, and this is all you need work with it, if you want to work with it. So this is A is an FP algebra, and then we have a family of rings. So for every n, we have such a ring, and as a set, it's just a tuple. Yeah. So then this is what you would call a vit vector of length n. Yeah? So a0 to an minus one, the ai are in A. This doesn't tell you how the ring structure is. And I also won't tell you explicitly how the ring structure is, but I give you some maps which encode the ring structure more or less. Yeah? So we have, first of all, we have the restriction map, which is you just forget the last entry in such a vit vector, and this is a ring map. And so this becomes then a pro ring via these restriction maps. And when you can take the limit, then you get again a ring. And but we have also a Frobenius, which goes also one level down. And this is, I mean, you still forget the last entry, but you also raise every entry to the p-th power. And this is also a ring map. Yeah? So the addition and multiplication here are defined in such a way that this is still a ring map. And then we have the Verschiebung, or the shift, which goes one level up, and it just inserts zero in the first place. And this is just a group homomorphism, so it doesn't preserve the multiplication. And then we have yet another map, which is called the Teichmüller lift usually. So this is goes from A to Wn of A, and you just consider the vit vector where you have A in the first place and then the last entries are zero. And this is multiplicative. And somehow the whole point of the vit vectors is that this is not an additive map. And in particular, when you add such a Teichmüller lift A plus Teichmüller lift B, you get a vit vector which has the form A plus B in the first component, but then you have entries here. Yeah, and you will have everywhere entries here. And actually, well, the second entry maybe you can compute, but already the third you don't want to compute anymore. Yeah, so there's a there's a way to find a formula, but it's completely useless. Yeah. So, but it exists. And so we have the properties which we have is that W1 is just A as a ring. And then we can write such a vit vector also as a Verschiebung applied to this Teichmüller lift. And then we take the sum inside the vit vectors. And then we also have this formula that when we first go up via the Verschiebung and then we go down via the Frobenius, this is multiplication by P, and then also the other way around. And this is interesting already. I mean, here you see when you add such a vector P times, what you do is you insert zero at the first place and then you raise everything to the p-th power. So when you go to the limit, then you consider vit vectors which are of infinite length. And then if A is reduced, then you see that you get a ring which is p torsion free. Yeah, and this is somehow the interest of the vit vectors, that in the limit, at least for reduced rings, you get a ring which is p torsion free, because multiplication by p is just shifting it to the right and raising it to the p's power. And here, this first entry is a p torsion ring. Yeah? So it's a kind of a canonical way to assign to an FP algebra a ring in characteristic zero, although this ring is not really nice, so it's not a flat lift or something. And then we have also another formula, which means that the Verschiebung is kind of Frobenius linear. Well, and if you put all these together and you think of it, you get almost all, I mean, you can figure out then how to multiply vectors here. And some of the only thing which is not clear is how to add two Teichmüller lifts. Okay, so these are the vit vectors and some fundamental properties. So when you take the vit vectors of Fp, yeah, so when I don't write an n here, then this means I take the limit. As this is just the p-adic integers, and if you have a perfect field, then and you take the vit vectors of not perfect field, just perfect ring, and if you take the vit vectors of this perfect ring, then this is a unique flat lift over z mod p to the nz of this a mod p. Yeah, because for a perfect ring, the derived cotangent complex vanishes, and then so all obstructions to lifting it.
Sorry, what do you mean by perfect ring? Because it may clash with the terminology in classical ring theory.
So what is a
perfect ring?
A perfect field or perfect ring, you mean?
Is a ring here?
Yeah.
What is a perfect ring here?
Okay, so the Frobenius is an isomorphism. So it's a it's an FP algebra, and the Frobenius is an isomorphism.
Okay, because there is a class of rings in ring theory, perfect rings. Okay, thanks for hearing.
Yes, sorry. So, and then also for general, so you can, of course, sheafify this construction also, so you get a sheaf of rings, and then this is representable by a ring scheme, which is then called WN. And actually, you can also, I mean, you can also do it for all schemes, so then you really get a ring scheme over Z. Yeah, but here we just restrict to this case. And any commutative unipotent FP group scheme is can be embedded into a direct sum of these WNs. Yeah, so you, I mean, it's a ring scheme, but in particular, it's then a group scheme, and somehow it's in a sense, it's a universal unipotent group scheme in the sense that every group scheme sits in a direct sum of these things. Okay, so this is the essential things about Witt vectors. Now the Durham-Witt complex. So as I said, I mean, originally it was introduced by Bloch, then somehow was more formal and more general than by Deligne-Ilhuy. So actually it is Ilhuy, but Ilhuy says it's it builds on the ideas by Deligne. And then, the way I present it maybe is mostly due to Hesselot Matz. I should say, so this is the Durham-Witt complex for a scheme is a pro-differential graded algebra. Yeah, so here the D is the differential in this algebra, and then the R here is the restriction map, so the transition map in the projective system. And then the degree zero part is just the Witt vectors. Then we have a Frobenius, which extends the Frobenius we had before, and it's a map of graded rings, of pro-graded rings. But a pro in a strict sense. And, so. And the Verschiebung is also a map of pro-graded groups, and it should also extend the Verschiebung on WO. And then we should have the following properties, again, that FV is a multiplication by P, and the Verschiebung should be F-linear. We have this relation with the differential, and then this one is maybe the most important relation here. So what this means is, so if you would just apply F to this Teichmüller lift and then you derivate it, so F of the Teichmüller lift is the Teichmüller lift to the P, and then when you apply the differential, then you get P times this. So somehow what this F here is you take the F from the Witt vectors, which you have, or the Frobenius by punctuality, it gives you a map here, but then you divide it by P. Yeah, and of course, this formally this makes no sense because you are on finite level N here, and then P is nilpotent on these things. But so you want, you just construct in such a way that this is possible. And so the Durham-Witt complex has all these properties, and then you can actually show that this is an initial object in the category of pro-differential graded algebras, which have these properties here and come with these maps. So let me say some other properties. So in degree one or length one, this is just the usual Durham complex. Absolute one, yeah, so over P. And what is also important is that for the usual Kähler differentials, we have this inverse Cartier operator, yeah, so which sends a form here, which is, I mean, every locally you can write every element here as a sum of elements of this form here. So this is A times, and then you take D log B1, batch blah, 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 batch B, D log B, J, where the BIs then are local units. And the inverse Cartier operator sends this to A to the P D log B. And some of the Frobenius here lifts this inverse Cartier operator to this level. So that you get maybe a bit of a feeling, how this looks like. So there are various constructions. The first construction was done by Bloch, originally in the case where the dimension of X or here of R is smaller equal P. But then this was extended by Cato, so it also works in general. And so here you take the Quillen K-theory of this truncated polynomial ring. And so you consider your RT modulo T to the N. And you take the kernel here under this map where T goes to zero. And then inside here, you consider the symbolic part, so only the elements which are in the image of Milnor K-theory, if you want. And then this T, okay, so there, this is like a formal thing which you can do, so you can cut out, so there's a projector which cuts out a certain P-typical part. So, and then Bloch used this, and actually this is as a pro object, so it's not quite clear whether this is really level-wise an isomorphism. Then Elizy used a more abstract way. So he defined general properties, but actually he did not define, so he did not take the Frobenius in the list of the general properties. He just asked for a Verschiebung to exist and then put some other conditions on this Verschiebung. And then he defines this inductively. He defines these quotients here, so that the Verschiebung exists with the properties, and then he shows that the Frobenius also exists. And then they've also found, so this was, I think, observed by Katz and was spelled out by Elizy Renault, that there's another description, namely when you have X is smooth over K and you take a smooth lift over the Witt vectors of K, and so K is now it's a perfect field of positive characteristic. And so locally, you always find such a smooth lift, then you have such an isomorphism. Yeah, and so actually you can show that this side here is independent of the lift. So somehow when you have local lifts, then you can glue it. And then you can also construct the differential and the Frobenius and the Verschiebung. I mean, only looking on this side. And somehow you can construct the Hodiard bit complex from this. So this may be the most explicit definition. Yeah? So this is the usual Deram complex here of this lift relative to WNK. And then there are many more ways to construct this. Yeah, Hesselhold Madsen had another way, Kunz-Deninger, and then there's a recent one, which is by Butler and Matthews. They actually have exactly the other way approach. So they start in the limit already, and then they construct it in a way that F exists, and then they show that this implies that V also exists. Okay, then the theorem which I mentioned at the beginning is that if X is smooth and you have here the change of sides map from the crystalline side to the Zariski side, and here you have the structure sheaf of the Zariski side, so this is the Zariski complex now which computes crystalline cohomology, and this is quasi isomorphic to the Sternbach complex. So this was, this is the theorem of Bloch and Elizy. And and then of course what I said before is also works here, that you have this slope spectral sequence which degenerates and gives you this description of the slope spaces. So what we don't need this. What we need is another result by Ekedal. So, and this is the following. So X is smooth over K, and then you can consider this scheme here, which is the topological space is the same as the one of X, but the structure sheaf is this one here. And so locally, when X is affine equals to spec A, then this is just a spec of Wn of A. And this is the thickening of X. Yeah? So you have X closed inside here. But this one lies now over the spec of Wnk. So it's a kind of a lift of X over Wnk, but it is not the lift one usually would like to have. Yeah, so it's neither smooth nor flat in general. But still, Ekedal showed that when you consider this ring here, so this is an injective, self-injective ring, so it's like a dualizing complex, and then you have the dualizing theory by Grothendieck for coherent sheaves. Grothendieck and Hartshorn developed this. And this you can apply in a quite general. Yeah? So this is a finite type map here, and it's separated, and if X is proper, then this is also proper. So you are in the realm where you can apply this Grothendieck duality, and you have this extraordinary inverse image. And so the statement is then that, so this is a dualizing complex, and this dualizing complex is in the category of coherent WNO OX modules, in the drive category, isomorphic to the top cohomology of this Dirac bit complex on X, shifted by the dimension of X. And then there's another result by Ekedal, which is also, which you know from the Dirac complex, that when you have an element here and you send it here by, you know, you wedge two elements together to get here, that this is an isomorphism. And this is actually, I mean, to get the R here is non-trivial because these are not locally free WN or X modules. And so this map here, this morphism, I mean, it's not smooth, not flat, and it's also not Gorenstein. So this is not locally free. And these are also not, but still you have such an isomorphism. And when you put this together, then this was done by Gros. Then for a proper map between smooth schemes, you get such a push forward. Yeah, so, I mean, roughly when you have here RF lower star WN JY, then you go here, then you rewrite this side here as F upper shriek, of the one on X, and then you use duality, and then you go, you take the trace to go to X, and then you go back with this isomorphism, and then there is a shift, of course, coming in. Okay, so why am I telling this? Because this is unfortunately actually what we need to show, that this is a reciprocity sheaf. Actually, the point is to show that we have finite transfers acting on the Dirac bit complex, namely, so this is, it follows from what I proved with Anne Kratzista-Matthieu, but we proved something much more general, and it would be nice to have a more more direct way to prove that this one here is a Nisnewitz sheaf with transfers, just finite transfers. So anyway, if you look what we do in this particular situation here, then this is, you take a finite correspondence in the sense of Vygotsky from X to Y. And now when you start on Y, you just pull it back to X times Y. Then you have a cycle class map, which was also constructed by Gros, and you take the cup product with it. So you go here and you have to take care of the support here. Yeah, so this is cohomology with support in this closed subset Z. And now this is, it's finite over X, so in particular proper, and then you can define the push forward here. Yeah, it's not exactly the same push forward as on the side before, because the projection map, I write F lower star here, it should be PX lower star here. Yes, so it's it's a projection map to X. This is not proper, but since you have to work here with the support, so then you can define it. Well, and then you can check that this is compatible with composition and so on. So this is this defines it in a Nisnewitz sheaf with transfers. And then we have to also check that any element here has a modulus. Yeah, but this is the proof here is very similar to the case of Kähler differentials, which I explained yesterday. So you can use some residue formula to show that you have a modulus. Okay. And maybe a remark which is very, which gives then rise to very interesting examples also, is that all these maps here, Frobenius, Verschiebung, restriction, and the differential, they are all morphisms of reciprocity sheaves, yeah? Meaning they are compatible with transfers. And this is maybe nice here. So here in this framework, this is much easier to show. This is very direct to show. Yeah, when here in this more general framework, this was quite complicated to show. I mean, so we were using there really much more of Ekedal's theory because, so let me just say one word here, namely, you see, I mean, there's this morphism coming in, and when you have a Frobenius or a Verschiebung on this side, you have to say what happens here on this side with it. And this is a bit tricky actually to follow through. And this is nice that here we don't need it. I mean, here is really a nice ad hoc argument to show that these are compatible. And then later on, we will see that we can extend these correspondence actions to cohomology and also take more general correspondences. And then we get automatically that everything is compatible with these maps here. Okay, so what the consequences we get from this is that, first of all, this Diambit complex is a complex bounded below complex of reciprocity sheaves. And it represents this crystalline complex here in the sense that when I restrict it to X, then this is quasi isomorphic to this one. And then we can also form this B infinity sheaves. And so maybe for the Deram complex, one writes B of omega J when you mean just the image under the differential. And then, so one can extend this a bit. So we have here, we can take the differential and then we apply the Frobenius. So then we go R levels down and then we are also here. And then this is actually an increasing sequence, yeah, because we have this formula FRD is the same as FR plus 1 DV, yeah, if you remember the relations from the beginning. So this is actually an increasing sequence, and so we can take the union, and then this is again a reciprocity sheaf. And these quotients here are reciprocity sheaves. And this is interesting because we have this generalized Artin-Schreier-Witt sequence on the Thal side of X. Yeah, so here we have to define, we have to divide out this B infinity in order to have that the Frobenius here is really an endomorphism. Yeah, it goes from the same sheaf to the same sheaf here. And usually the Frobenius was defined as going from level n plus one to here. And so now here the definition is you lift it and then you go here. And then because we divide this out here on both sides, this becomes an endomorphism. So this becomes well defined. And so this is surjective in the et al. Topology. And then here we have this kernel. These are the log forms. So this is, yeah, if you want, you can define it as a kernel of this map, or an alternative description is that it is like the image of the Milner K theory, of the Jace Milner K theory under the D-log map. So it's like locally generated by elements of the form D-log of Teichmüller lift U1 product with blah, 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 D-log of Teichmüller lift UJ, where the UIs are local units on X. And So why do I call it generalized Artin-Schreier-Witt? Because when you go here j equals zero, then here you have the usual bit vectors. The B infinity is zero for j equals zero, and here this is just z modulo p to the n that, and this is what we call the Artin-Schreier sequence. So this generalizes this. And now we have Geiser-Levin tell us that this sheaf, when we twist it by minus j, is actually as isomorphic to the et al. Motivic complex with mod p to the n coefficients in weight j. But these sheaves here are, they are not directly coherent, but they are limit of co-limits of coherent sheaves. So they are R epsilon lower star is cyclic, yeah, where epsilon is here the change of topology from the et al. To Nisnevich or et al. To Zariski, as you know. So these are R epsilon lower star is cyclic, so which means that this complex you can view as representing R epsilon lower star of this thing. Yeah, and so when we take in Geiser-Levin, we get that this R epsilon lower star of this motivic complex here, yeah, so this is a Zariski complex whose cohomology is equal to the et al. Cohomology with mod p to the n coefficients in weight j. And this one is represented by this complex here, shifted by minus j. And so this is again a complex of reciprocity sheaves. So also the cohomology sheaves here then are reciprocity sheaves. And so when you add Voivodsky, then you know here in the prime 2p part, then you know anyway, these are homotopy invariant sheaves. So we get that all these sheaves here, which give rise to the unramified cohomology when you take global sections over a proper scheme, they all are reciprocity sheaves. And in particular, the Brouwer group, X goes to the Brouwer group. So this is a way to describe the Brouwer group is a reciprocity sheaf. So we see many nice examples. Yeah, the Dram-Witt complex is a reciprocity sheaf, but then from the fact that that all these maps here, Frobenius and differential and so on, they are all compatible with the transfers. This gives us many more reciprocity sheaves. And then, of course, I mean, we have to throw in also big results here. Yeah? So,
sorry, but your reciprocity sheaf, could you recall, please, they are not necessarily a one invariant by definition.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, so this is... So some of the interesting ones are not A1, but are the only ones where we can say something new. Yeah. So, yeah. Mm-hmm. But I should say this one here. So when you just use this as a Zariski sheaf, this is A1 invariant, but then the co-kernel here is not A1 invariant. Okay. So now, so we want to compute this modulus in certain examples. This is, on the one hand, this will give you the link at the yesterday. At the beginning, I said that this A1 invariant theory doesn't see like higher poles or ramification and things like this. So we will see that here we see these things, and then also these computations will be also used then later on and tomorrow to apply the theory. Okay, so. So we say L in the following, L will always be a Hensilian discrete valuation field of geometric type, by which I mean that you have a smooth scheme, you have a one four-dimensional point in the smooth scheme, you look at the local ring and its Hensilization, you take the fraction field of this, then, so this is then what we call a Hensilian discrete valuation field of geometric type over K. And then when we have a reciprocity sheaf, then we write just f of L for f of spec of L. And this is, of course, to be understood as a limit or as a co-limit over all the smooth models of this L. And then here also we write f tilde of OL M. So OL is, of course, a ring of integers of L, and M is a maximal ideal. And we write this for this one here. So for f tilde of spec OL n times a closed point, this again has to be understood as taking a limit over pairs, I mean, so the closed point, so you can find a smooth model of OL, and then this closed point, you can spread it out also to a smooth divisor inside this, and then you have this multiplicity here. So recall that this was yesterday, when we have X, D, then these are those elements which have a modulus, some compactification of X, D. And now, so I should say, I mean, everything which I say now is in this joint work with Shuji Saito. Yeah. So in particular, this formula here, so this is a proper modulus pair. So and these elements here, so these are elements in here, which have the following property that whenever I have a map from spec L, yeah, such an L here, to this complement, then this extends because X bar is proper to a map of spec OL to X bar. And then I can pull back A to F of L. And I want that this actually lies in this part here. Yeah? So where here we pull back D to spec of OL, and we look at the multiplicity here, and we want that it lies in here. So this means, somehow we have we can understand the sections here by just looking at discrete valuation fields of geometric type mapping to our modulus pair here, and then we pull back A. So it suffices to understand this filtration. And so we have here f of OL, we have f of L, and this is the filtration inside here. And somehow when you have an A1 invariant sheaf, then this filtration, so this is already all of FL. Yeah? So then this breaks down. But for general reciprocity sheaves, this is an increasing filtration. It's exhaustive, but it will not stop. It's an infinite increasing filtration. So this is actually an interesting property of reciprocity sheaves. They have a level, which means in this above situation, it suffices to do this only if the transcendence degree of L over K is bounded by N. Yeah, so when you here, you say you have this equality, but instead of going over all L, you go just over those L where the transcendence degree is over K is less or equal N. Then if this suffices, then you say F has level N. So for example, if it has level one, then it means you can check. So when you have an element here, then you can check whether it lies in here by just pulling back two curves. So it's a cut by curve criterion then. And there is a criterion for level N. This may be a bit technical now. So you want it, so essentially it says, so you have A is an F of A1x. And now you assume that it is when you at infinity, it is, yeah, it has most, yeah, I should say what you say, it's most tamely ramified, it has at most log poles or something like this. Yeah, so we have just a one here. For all x, which are at most n minus one dimensional, if this set is equal to x, yeah, so every such section actually comes via pullback from x, then f has level n. Yeah, so this is, if you computed these groups here, then this is a criterion which you can check. Okay, now let me give you some computations. So the first theorem is, this is now all in characteristic zero here. When you take the absolute scalar differentials, and you can do the same also with the relative ones, so over K, then this is a cube invariant sheaf, yeah, as discussed yesterday, and it has level J plus one. And and this is an explicit formula here, so you can compute this. Yeah. So this side is defined somehow by certain conditions how correspondences act. Yeah. So this is cut out inside omega J of L via cycle actions or correspondence actions. And so this is an explicit description here. T is a local parameter of some maximal idea. And then we can also consider rank one connections on X or integrable rank one connections. And then, so this assigning X to this group, yeah, isomorphism classes actually here, induces, so this gives a reciprocity sheaf, this one. And if you don't, for general rank one connections, this has level two. So you need to pull back to surfaces somehow or to decide whether something has a certain modulus. But if it's integrable, then it has level one. Yeah, so this is this cut by curve criterion, this was also mentioned in the talk by Piotr Achinger in the conference. There he was talking also about higher rank connections. I mean, here rank one is, this is a kind of easy case. And then we have this explicit description here of, we can form this cube invariant sheaf and we can consider these sections which have modulus x comma d. And then these are the isomorphism classes of respectively integrable rank one connections on X whose non-log irregularity is bounded by D. Yeah, so this irregularity was introduced by Deligne before, and then, well, there's a non-log version, so you just shift things by one. This sheaf here, which we cut out motivically inside via cycle actions inside this reciprocity sheaf, gives you exactly those which where the irregularity is bounded. Let me give you an example in a positive characteristic now. This looks a little bit horrible, but let me say, so this filtration here, this is a filtration on the bit vectors. Yeah, so this is a subgroup of Wn of L, L is as before. And this was considered by Kato Russell, actually part of these filtrations here, they also were appearing before in work of Brilinski, Kato, and Matsuda. And they were introducing it in order to define, to build generalized Albanese maps and to define a modulus, yeah, so somewhat to generalize what Sayer and Rosenlicht did. And okay, so this is a filtration. So this is built up by these strange things. Is this fill lock? And maybe, yeah, we can have a look at it just to see that it behaves a bit strange. So we have, when we have n equals one, yeah, so then you have just L and you consider a zero, then this means that that it is in here, means that a zero has a pole of most order r. But if you are on n, level n, then and you consider a zero, then it means a has a pole at most of order r to the divided by p to the n minus one. So the bigger the n is, the smaller is the pole order here in the first place, and then also in the second and so on. So it's not, the restriction map on these things is not subject. Yeah, well, and then you have to Frobenius satirize this sum here. So this is maybe not so, I mean, we don't want to spend too much time on this, but what is interesting is that such a kind of complicated looking filtration is exactly the one which comes out here, which we get in a very nice description here on this side. Yeah? So like a very general description. And this gives, when you compute it, you get this. And even in when you just take n equals one, then this is the case of GA. And this is even not what you maybe would have guessed immediately. Yeah, so it's just OL if R is less or equal to one. And if P is prime to R to one, then it's this one here. So this is the part which you also get in characteristic zero. So this is the case of the Kähler differentials for J equals zero. This would give you this one here, but then you have to Frobenius saturate it. And if P divides R, then you get this one here. And yeah, so let me say why this Frobenius saturation appears is because this construction is completely functorial and you have a Frobenius in positive characteristic. So this group here has to be stable under Frobenius. So somehow you are forced to Frobenius saturate it. And well, I mean, some of these, that these differences here, you can also understand them by, yeah, by looking at the differentials, that this is also a map of reciprocity sheaves, and then this also put certain constraints. Okay, so there's then this Brzezinski-Kato-Matsuda filtration on this group here. So these are the finite characters on the absolute Galois group of L. And they define this filtration in this way. So fill R is just the whole prime to P part, yeah, because this is A1 invariant, so there's nothing is happening. And then we look at this filtration, which we just had, and somehow we have a natural map here via the, so the map goes first, of course, to H1 etal L of Z modulo P to the N, that Z, which we can then map here. And this map is a connecting homomorphism from stemming from the Artin-Schreier-Witt sequence. Yeah, so this is what this natural map is here. And yeah, so as a theorem, so when epsilon is again this change of site maps, then we have here this R1 epsilon lower star Q mod Z. And so this is like this motivic homology in weight zero. Yeah. this is a reciprocity sheaf and it has level one, so you can decide whether something is has modulus x comma d by cutting these curves. And then this cube invariant sheaf here is characterized exactly by this Brzezinski-Kato-Matsuda filtration. And actually, this was introduced in order to generalize the Artin conductor from the case of perfect residue field. Yeah, so when you have I write this here. So we have this equality. So these are homomorphisms from the absolute Galois group to Q mod Z, and then originally you had a ramification filtration on this Galois group here, which was defined when the residue field of L is perfect. And somehow this was introduced to generalize this filtration. So and then here we also get like in a motivic way directly a generalization of this filtration to arbitrary residue fields. Or, I mean, okay, the residue fields are function fields, but yeah. Yatagawa actually showed also that this filtration here, this is also the homomorphisms from GL modulo GLR plus QZ, where this one here now is a generalization of this ramification filtration for general L, which was introduced by Abbes and Takeshi Saito. And so somehow, of course, this part here, since you go to Q mod Z, this only sees a billionized thing here, but then you can take the double dual and you get kind of a motivic description of this billionized quotient. Here we have this weight zero. So there's a question, what is with the other cohomology, like tile motivic cohomology groups here? So first of all, I mean, when we put Wolodzki and Geisser-Levine together, we see that all these groups here are a homotopy invariant, except I in the degree where I is not J plus one. So the interesting part happens here. And if I is J plus one, then we can again decompose it here in a prime 2P part, which is homotopy invariant. Then we have here the P part. This part here I call HJ plus one. This is still a reciprocity sheaf, it's not homotopy invariant. Now we get a filtration. So now I write here HJ. So this is RJ epsilon lower star of QP mod ZP J minus one. So we get a filtration here, which measures the difference to A1 invariants. So the A1 invariant things would stop here, but here we have this whole filtration. And above, we determined these groups, so for J equals one. And so the question is, can we also compute this here? And so this is almost done, but not everything is completely written, so I don't want to make definite statements here, but let me say, I mean, this of course looks very complicated. I'm sorry, but I just want to show you that that the filtrations, when you really compute them, it looks very messy in a sense, at least when you look at it first time. Yeah. But then it's nice to see that these filtrations, they have this nice motivic definition. Yeah. I don't want to say too much here. It's just that here, essentially, we have the same filtrations as before, and the bit vectors appear, but we tensor them one time here with the Milner K-series of L and one time with the Milner K-series of OL, and we look at the image here. And then via this generalized Artin-Schreier-Witt sequence, which I was introducing before, via this connecting homomorphism, there we get a natural map here, and then we define this filtration on this on this motivic cohomology in this form. Then we can define these sheaves. Yeah, so for a proper modulus pair, we define it. So the definition is the same as the one for the tilde, except that here I don't have this tilde filtration, but I put here this filtration, which we defined by hand somehow. The proposition is that this also defines you a cube invariant Nisnewitz sheaf and M-Rob's reciprocity and semi-purity. When you restrict it just to usual smooth schemes, so when you evaluate it at X comma empty set, then you get back the usual HJ. So some of these two here implies that we have that this at least sits in here. I should say, I mean, yeah, it's almost the proof that this is equal is almost done, but it's not. Yeah. So it's a work in progress. Yeah. But I would be very surprised if it's not equal. Yeah. Let me just remark that Kato defined also a filtration here before, yeah, generalizing this filtration of Brzezinski and Matsuda. This filtration here compares with Kartoff's filtration. It's not exactly the one, but it sits inside these things. Okay, maybe one last example. We can also consider, we are still in positive characteristic and we can then consider finite K groups. We can write such a group as as a product, because we are a perfect field. This is etal multiplicative groups. This is an etal unipotent group. This is an infinitesimal multiplicative group. This is an infinitesimal unipotent group. And so examples are, I mean, for etal multiplicatives, this is just Z mod L, where L is not P. Etal unipotent is Z mod P, where P is a characteristic. Infinitesimal multiplicative would be mu P. And infinitesimal unipotent would be alpha P. And then we can consider this functor here, which sends an X to the first FPPF cohomology of these coefficients in this, this group. Finite group scheme, and this classifies isomorphism classes of G torsors, FPPF G torsors over X. And then the theorem is that H1G is also a reciprocity sheaf, and it has level 2. And if the infinitesimal unipotent part is 0, then it has level 1. And so, I mean, okay, the multiplicative part somehow is a homotopy invariant, and then there is not a general description of the unipotent part, but at least here in this central building blocks, you can say that this one here, so well, this one we saw before already, but here this one for alpha p, this is also induced by this filtration. So because alpha p in the FPPF topology, you have a exact sequence, alpha p goes to ga, goes via Frobenius to ga. It forms an exact sequence, and so you have a map then from ga to the first cohomology of alpha p, and so this filtration is induced by this one. Okay, so and I think this was this is a completely new example. Yeah, so this the ramification of these torsors, as far as I know, this wasn't studied before. Okay, so now let me see what is the time. So I have like 10 more minutes. So let me, then say a bit about tensor products and twists, because this is what we will use tomorrow. When we have two reciprocity sheaves, then we can define a new reciprocity sheaf, and we tensor them together. So what you do is you first make tilde, so you make a cube invariant sheaf of it, and then you tensor them as modulus pre-sheaves with transfers. You make some cube invariant again. You go to pre-sheaves with transfers, and then the Nisnevich sheaf you fight. And then somehow we saw yesterday that this thing is then again a reciprocity sheaf. So you, this is another way to create new reciprocity sheaves. We would like to write here a tensor, but it's not clear whether this is really a monoidal structure. Yeah? So the associativity is not clear. Alberto Merici told me that he's working on this, so maybe he has a way to prove the associativity. Yeah? But at the moment, it's not known. It's not clear that this is right exact. Because of course, I mean, this tensor product here is right exact, and this taking this H0 quotients here is right exact, and this omega lower shriek is anyway exact. But this tilde function here, so which is this functor omega upper ci, this is not right exact. This somehow has, at some point before I said that some filtration on the Witt vectors, that it wasn't surjective, the restriction map. Yeah, so this is one way to see that this is not right. Anyway, although, we don't yet know whether this is like a completely nice monoidal structure, at least it's a Lex monoidal structure, and we can prove some things with it. So this is joint with Sugiyama and Yamazaki. And so when F and G are homotopy invariant Nisnevich sheaves, then this is just the usual old tensor product of homotopy invariant Nisnevich sheaves. And when you are in characteristic zero and you tensor a unit ball, you take this thing, let me say just tensor, and you tensor G unipotent with an abelian variety, then you get zero. When you take GA with GM, then you get the absolute Kähler differentials. Well, you could also iterate this. You take several times GM and then you get higher differentials. And when you take GA, GA, then you get this thing. Here, so you, this is the ideal of the diagonal, and you square it. So this is the sheaf on X, and this is what you get. Yeah. And now the twists, which will come up tomorrow also, so like a Tate twist, so is so if G is a cube invariant sheaf, then we define this G twisted by M. Do tensors with Milner K theory, I mean, like the tilted version, but this is homotopy invariant, so this is just the same as omega upper star of Milner K theory. And then you tensor it with G and you make it cube invariant, semi pure, phi it and takes in the Nishnovich sheaf, you phi it. Then you are here. Ah, I should say, with the notation I had before, I should write here an A underline this. And then we have also this gamma N, which is we take the inner HOM in MPST from here to here, and then it is automatically also here when G was a cube invariant sheaf. And well, it's nice to write it with the Milner K theory, but somehow these computations, which I like this one here, and then the corresponding computation for Milner K theory, that you can write it as a tensor product of GM of homotopy invariant sheaves. This is needed in order that you have formulas like GN, G of twisted N minus one twisted by one is G of N or something. So that this makes sense. There's some work to do. And well, here for reciprocity sheaves, there it's not so easy. This is like the missing associativity. So there we define just a twist by one. So we make this product with GM. And then we define it recursively in this way. And then for gamma N, we also define it like this. And then, but here we have it automatically. So gamma, when I apply another gamma, then that's the same as gamma N plus one. And yeah, so this is then also an important theorem for us. And in the following, this is this result by Merici and Saito, or one part of this result is that if F is a reciprocity sheaf, and so we twist it by N and we apply this, untwisting if you want this gamma N, then this is just F tilde. And also, so this is on the level of cube invariant sheaves and this is on the level of reciprocity sheaves. But I think if I remember right, they don't, they cannot prove this formula here for an arbitrary cube invariant sheaf. I mean, of this form, but it has to be of this form, the tilde of a reciprocity sheaf. And yeah, okay. And this, of course, yeah, this generalizes part of Vygotsky's cancellation theorems, yeah, for H1 invariant Nishnovich sheaves. And so let me stop with giving some formulas, which will then be used somehow everywhere. Is yeah, so this is kind of clear from what I said before, that when you twist Z, with n, then you can get Milner K theory, and also here at this reciprocity sheaf level. In characteristic zero, you get also this description of this cube invariant sheaf here. It's just a GA tilde twisted by n. And then also here on this reciprocity sheaf level. But note that you get the absolute differentials, yeah, not over K. And well, in characteristic P, it looks a bit different. So this that I have to exclude 2, 3, 5 is a bit, yeah, this is a technical reason, but this should not be here. But of course, P should not be zero. And then here again, we have, since the Frobenius acts, we can only get something here on which like, we have a Frobenius endomorphism. Yeah, and we don't have a Frobenius endomorphism on the absolute differentials. So somehow something like this has to come up. And yeah. So all these proofs here actually use the computations which I explained before. And so this one here uses this last thing, which was work in progress. And there was not, this tilde was not completely determined, but the part which I stated, the part which is definitely proved, this is sufficient to prove this here. Yeah? So it's because I had an inclusion, I had a filtration, which I understand, and I knew this was inside here, and this suffices to define a well-defined map from here to here. And yeah, and then furthermore, also we have formulas for gamma. So this is, yeah, so when we apply this gamma n to the Witt complex, and we just cancel here some of the n in the top part. This formula is also true in characteristic zero for the Dram bit for the Dram complex. Then it's also in this paper by Merici and Saito. And this one is here in this paper with Binder and Saito. And yeah, so somehow it follows from, so you use this like a simple version of the blow up for, of the projective bundle formula. And you actually, you can only, it suffices when you use it for omega one, and then you can deduce this form from this here. And this we will use tomorrow then to make the abstract formulas to translate them to actual formulas which you can use then. And I think, yeah, and this is where I want to stop for today. And then, as I said, tomorrow then we will use everything what I explained today, and we will get a kind of very general understanding of the cohomology of reciprocity sheaves. Yeah, okay, thank you.
Hey, Kai, thanks for a most interesting talk. We can all unmute and give the speakers some applause. Okay, then are there any comments or questions? Maybe I can start by asking the exceptions you have about the characteristic P, different from 2, 3, and 5. Do you expect that to
yeah, as I said, they should not be there. And okay, so the reason is that so when you define this here, there's this GA tilde, but you can to the cube invariant sheaves, there's also another lift of GA tilde. So there's another sheaf when you apply omega lower shriek, which gives you GA. And this is the one, if you use this in this definition here, then you actually get the Kähler differential. So this is what we prove with Sugiyama and Yamazaki. So there, like when you understand the filtrations, you get a natural map in this direction. And then to construct a map in this direction, well, you have to present this here in a certain way, and then there are relations, and you have to kill the relations. And this is kind of a lot of work to find the right relations here. And somehow we just couldn't find the relations here. Yeah, but they are there, I'm sure. Yeah, so I'm sure this is unnecessary, but it's some work to do. Yeah, to find the other relations there, which work in this case. So the relations where we which we were using, they used that we can invert all these numbers. Yeah. Yeah, sorry for this, yeah.
Okay, thanks. So, any other questions or comments?
Can you remind me what it means to say that something has a level JSA?
Okay, it suffices to consider the transcendental degree of L over K is less or equal N, and so where? Here. Yeah. So here we have these sheaves here, which are abstractly defined, and then we take this, they are defined by these correspondence actions, and so we want to, so here I say we can consider, we can describe these sections in this form by just pulling back to all these L's, to all these Hanselian discrete valuation fields, and then ask for a certain formula. And that it has level N means you don't have to pull back to all these Hanselian discrete valuation fields, but only to those where the transcendence degree is less or equal N, the transcendence degree over K. And so when you have level one, then it means you can only, you can understand this by pulling back to curves, yeah, so to really to discrete valuation fields where the residue field is perfect. And when it's level two, then you have to somehow, you have to pull, I mean, then this U has to have dimension two.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hey, anybody else? So just feel free to ask questions. Okay, it doesn't seem to be the case. Then Kai's third lecture is tomorrow at 2 p.m. So we meet again then.